Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Trolling with Logic for the 28th of May. And as yet, we're back this time, and our guest is with us. So, very quickly introduce everyone. And Marty, again, how's it going?
Yeah, I'm up to my ass in work, but I'm taking the time to be here.
All right. And Nathan, what's happening?
It's the end of a very long, hard week, and I'm glad it's my weekend.
All right. And Pumpkin, what are you saying to it?
If you take what Marty said and add in what Nathan said, you can make so many jokes out of it. I'm up to my ass in work. I had a long, hard week.
Oh, yes. And so, Kitch, what's happening?
Jesus, Carl, it's been far too long since we've last talked, hasn't it?
Yes, it's just been all of 30 seconds, I think. Anyway, as you can see, we do have our special guest with us. And just to remind you, everyone, you can call in at any time. Add the Skype contact, Trolling with Logic. I'll PM you and we'll add you to the call in due course. So, Kitch, take it away with the introduction of our guest.
Grant. So, today we are joined by, apologies if I mispronounce your name, Yvette D'Entremont, aka The Science Babe, who's a pro-science blogger who tackles alt-med and other pseudoscience movements. She has a bachelor's in chemistry and a master's in forensic science, and also a bachelor's in theatre. She has a background in analytical science. You can read her blog at The Science Babe. Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
It's great to have you on.
I was a little confused when you said someone was greeted as Pumpkin. I'm like, is that a pet name? That's such a delightful way to greet one of your lads. I love this show already. You guys are just the people I want to hang out with. Now, I like to ask before we get rolling on a podcast, is swearing allowed here? Because I'm a little sweary.
Fuck yes.
Oh yes.
Pumpkin. Whenever I do a talk, because other than writing, public speaking is the big way that I work. It's the big way that I make a living. Whenever I give a talk, I always have to ask, can I swear? And like half the time, because I'll give talks like in the deep south, and they look at me like, no. I'm like, oh shit, this is not my, these are not my people.
Well, this
how do
is
I?
The
how
internet.
Do I do this? Oh yeah, but it's like, but I mean, some podcasts are like, they're. Like, we have to put an explicit warning on this, but like whenever they say go ahead and swear, I'm like, I will drop the F-bomb within the first like 40 seconds of it. They're like, what have we done? So like they don't expect me, who shows up looking very businesslike, to have the mouth that could make a sailor blush. I'm like, this is what all those years of Catholic school did to me. Sorry.
Pumpkin. we'll get Pumpkin. Can you expand on the swearing policy for us? I think you're the best person.
I just want to say it's an absolute fucking travesty when someone comes in and swears on this fucking show. I mean, it's just the sheer fucking disgusting, verbose shit that just smears out of their mouth like so much crap out of an anus. It's disgraceful. And I would like to say, the way you said when you do talks in the Deep South and they just say no, when I'm in the, if I was in the Deep South, that would when I'd really need to fucking swear.
Yeah, it's here's the saddest thing. It's within a short period of time, I did a talk for the American Atheist Convention, and then I also did a talk for the Southwest Meat Association. Now, I talk about food myths a lot, so that's why I do talks within the food industry. American Atheist Convention, obviously, no praying was happening. But then at and here's both of them were in the South because they like the American Atheist. They do like to kind of go to places where they're not normally welcome and be like, hi, we're here. But then for the Southwest Meat Association, that one was held in Texas. I'd never been to Texas before. They started the convention with a prayer and ended, I shit you not, by auctioning off a gun. I'm like, oh damn, I am not with my people. I lived in England for a year, and like everyone looked at me like with, you know, like you kind of accidentally turn into an ambassador for your country, and everyone's like, right, so what's the gun policy? And I'm sorry, I'm butchering a British accent. Don't kill me. But like, I'm sorry, you don't have guns. But like everyone's like, so you guys are all mad about guns over there, right? I'm like, no, I don't live with those people. They're kind of all crazy down in the Deep South. But there's a nutty contingent of this country, and they're all voting for Trump, it seems. No. And I'm sorry. I didn't do it. I'm not responsible for it.
Okay, so shall we get on with the? We'll get into the. Kitch.
There's all the tangenty stuff.
There'll probably be more tangents. We welcome tangents here. So, Kitch, away you go for the introductories.
Grant, so what's actually got you started on blogging?
It was a combination of things. So I always like to say that not to blame the victim, the people that fall prey to all of these charlatans that are out there saying, you know, that diet will cure all of your ills and that supplements are better than real medicine. Well, I kind of fell for some of the dietary bullshit that I try to debunk now. Now, I always ask this question, what's the longest headache any of you guys have had? Like, most of the time when I ask this, people will say anywhere from a few hours to maybe up to 2 weeks. That sound about right?
Yeah, 48 hours for me.
Kitch, what was your longest hangover?
I think it was the time we had an FNM 3 on those years ago. Thanks for bringing that up in the pre-show, by the way.
You can make a joke about when the Spice Girls were popular. I don't know. I got a headache on March 7th of 2010 and it never went away. And yes, I've tried Excedrin. Paracetamol has been looked into. But there was, I was going to all of the doctors I should. And the things like this, refractory pain that can't be seen on a scan, that they can't, you know, that they're not sure what to do with, it takes a long time to treat. It's kind of throw a seizure medication or a tricyclic antidepressant at it and see what sticks, see what drug I can tolerate and see what thing my body's responsive to at what dose and see which combination of meds work. But while the doctors were, you know, playing Yvette as a test tube, Yvette went looking online, and this is where I got into a little bit of trouble because, you know, I was still listening to my doctors because I was a science-based person, but I was, you know, I was scared, I was in a lot of pain, I was desperate, I was vulnerable, and when all those things happen, I had my master's degree by then, I had been working as a scientist for a few years, but I was fucking scared. Like, I had the worst pain of my life centered around my left eye every day of my life. That'll make you make some stupid fucked up decisions. Like, that'll make you hunt through blogs like Mercola and Vonnie Harry's blog and all of those nutty blogs that I tell people are completely full of shit now. And you're like, wow, like, that, exactly. It's like, and at the same time, like, when this happened, I was really overweight. I was I weighed over 240 pounds. I'm not exactly a size 2 now, but I'm at a much healthier weight. But you know, of course, when you have a symptom like that and you're overweight, people are like, of course, it's the fat in your thighs causing the pain in your face. I'm like, yeah, that makes sense, totally. But you know, I got myself into better shape. I lost about 90 pounds. Started running marathons. I've got a giant fucking collection of medals. The running did not make the pain go away, though. I went vegan for 2 years. I tried going organic. I even tried going paleo. Dark time in my life. Like, I tried everything. I tried cutting out I was that person who looked at, microphone. I looked at like every single package I saw on a shelf. Like, if it had anything that was GMO, that was soy, that was canola, anything that I might have thought that might have something toxic in it, I wouldn't touch it because I was so afraid that was triggering this horrible pain. And eventually I found a doctor that treated me, that got this under control. And I was, you know, I was kind of upset with myself for falling for it because I was a scientist. I should have known better. I was upset then I realized, you know, there's so much misinformation out there that it was easy to fall for. And I was in pain. I was hunting. So people who aren't scientifically versed, it must be that much easier for them to fall for it. I have cats that are about to run in front of my computer screen. I apologize if that happens. Welcome to a life with a household full of cats. I blame my boyfriend. Two of them are his. Anyways, that's the kind of scary thing about it is that I was really scientifically knowledgeable, and because I was scared and miserable, I could fall for all this bullshit. So after I was treated, I started working at a pesticide company. Now, this is kind of where things got rolling. I already had kind of figured out the food babe was full of shit. But then, like, when I was really working in the industry, I saw all the regulations that were in place on pesticides. Like, if something wasn't tested down to the last, like, 0.01% pure, if we hadn't tested for every last impurity, things wouldn't go to market. I would hold up a pesticide being registered in a foreign country for months because we hadn't made sure it was safe yet. So this is a highly regulated industry, and people like the Food Babe are just saying, there are no regulations. I'm like, yeah, I basically just lick the vial, say it's probably not going to kill your kids, and go back to watching porn for 8 hours a day at my desk. I'm just kidding. It's 2 hours max. 2 hours. Only on Thursdays. But, like, you know, I just started, you know, I have a perverted sense of humor. I said, fuck it, I'm going to throw the pervy sense of humor, the science, and the shit that I went through all into a blog and see if it sticks. And it fucking stuck. Like, that's the whole story behind it, is I went through it. I'm a scientist, and I wanted people to know what was really happening. And I've had other stupid little blogs about my life before. Like, I've always kind of, you know, been a decent writer. But I've really been shocked at how well this took off. And I'm glad to do it, because I think people deserve to have the good information out there, because I don't want people to fall for the shit.
Yeah.
So there's the long and short of it. So
take it away, guys.
Go ahead and throw some more stuff at me.
I can actually relate to the whole idea of using alternative ways to deal with the pain. I've been active in martial arts for 20 plus years, and I've had my share of injuries, and I've used, I'm...
Meditation, yoga.
I'm
not
really
making fun of you saying that at all. I'm saying that it's perfectly fine to deal with pain with things other than painkillers.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
I'm not on Percocet. Like, that's, I'm not saying you should be downing all the, take all the opiate. That's not what I'm saying at all. Like, I'm on a seizure medication and an anti-inflammatory. And without those, I would be in such crippling pain every day with, like, and it's nerve pain is what it is. Yeah. I basically have a nerve that's misfiring. And depending on which neurologist I go to, I get a different diagnosis. But the most recent one I saw said it's a type of headache, a 2 in a million type headache called Sunk syndrome, where basically the nerve behind your eye flares up. My left, now if I was completely unmedicated, went off everything for 2 weeks, got it out of my system, I would have a dull ache on the left side of my head. My left eyeball would get red and tear up. My left nose would clog up. And I mean, I would, like, this is the type of symptom or disorder that you would be like, this doesn't happen. Nobody actually gets this. Hi, lucky caller 1000, or 500,000 in this case. Let's see, the left side of my face would droop. Like, people would think I was having a stroke. It was crazy. Now, when one of these attacks would happen, this isn't once in a while. The dull ache would be constant, but these attacks would happen 60 to 100 times a day, and they would last for 30 seconds to 3 minutes, and it was a 10 on the pain scale. Like, I would be sitting at my desk crying at work, and I was working in a lab with hazardous chemicals. That couldn't be happening if I'm sitting there playing with, or, you know, working with and analyzing with very concentrated sodium hydroxide or something very corrosive. That was just dangerous. So it needed to be treated because I was put on paperwork duty and my lab needed me to be able to work. So it was scary thinking at the age of 27, if they couldn't treat this, I was going to be, you know, they were just going to eventually chuck me onto Percocet and say, bye, just, you know, sit on your ass and be... and, you know, don't have a career. Like, that was horrifying to me that could happen. I'm like, I just finished my master's.
Guys, can you hear me? Because it's just cut out for me. Is anybody else hearing me? Hello, everyone. Yeah, it's... There's no one else hearing me, is there? All right.
Here are two other little bits to it. Pain in young people is often, they've shown studies on this, pain in young people is often brushed off and undertreated because they look at you thinking automatically that you're a drug seeker. I did my master's thesis on prescription opiate abuse trends in the US and the UK. UK, because I was curious what the difference, because when I moved over there, the show House with Hugh Laurie was very popular, but my especially all my friends that were studying for, loved it as well. None of them had heard of the drug Vicodin, because they don't prescribe it in the UK.
Yeah.
So I was like, huh, if they don't prescribe it in the UK, there's a huge addiction problem with it in the US. I'm like, if they don't prescribe it over here, there must not be an addiction problem with it over here. So what are the, you know, people are going to find ways to fuck up their brain wherever they are, because it's fun to get a little fucked up. Let's not lie. Is there anyone in this room who has never smoked pot, or in this virtual room who has never smoked pot?
Actually.
All right. Come to California. We'll take care of you. It's legal enough out here. We'll handle you. Moving on. And as someone who's worked in drug talks, it'll be out of your system in 3 days max if you just smoke it once.
It's not that I'm afraid of it. It's that where I live, it's illegal.
I understand. But no, by the time you get back to back home, it'll be out of your system. That's the
he's a law-abiding little Norwegian boy.
What I was gonna say though, because I was saying I could relate to it, because I've had plenty of injuries, I've had a lot of injuries where it's like, okay, this isn't serious enough that I need medical treatment, but it's serious enough that it's hindering me in I can't do certain moves because it hurts, you know, stuff like that. But I really need to stay active. So I've been using painkillers that are sort of, well, not painkillers, but methods for relieving pain that are just, okay, so it doesn't really work, but it treats the symptom. Mm-hmm. So it allows me to keep going. And I mean, yeah, okay, so I know I'm probably making myself worse in the long run, but, you know, it's a conscious choice. I know what I'm doing. I want to keep practicing right now. Yeah. I'll rest after this important event, you know?
I've done that before, too. It's with distance running. Like, I know my hip is bad. I know I should rest. I'm just going to keep on foam rolling until I get through this marathon and ignore how bad the pain is, and then it turned out I needed surgery. But like, there's, you know, you do things because you want to do something with, like, you can, there are certain pains that you can ignore and you can push away and find ways to mitigate them, and then there are certain pains that are
cut out again, I think.
Give it, quote unquote, giving into pain is not being, it's not being a pussy. It's not, it's not your way of not being strong. It's your way of addressing a problem with the body. And I think people aren't realistic about pain all the time. And I think that's also, it's something that the alternative medicine market preys on, both with physical and mental pain, because the number of times I see memes coming out saying, you know, like a picture of nature saying, this is an antidepressant, and then a pill of an actual antidepressant saying, this is shit. I mean, these are people that have never met a seriously clinically depressed person. Yeah. And this is, it's horrifying to me that they prey on the mentally ill people that are, that might stumble across us, that are desperate for relief. Cause that's a big theme within the alternative health racket, is they're preying on desperate, vulnerable people. And I hope that these people will come around to science, because it can help them much better than things that aren't proven. Like, I'd be willing to consider that maybe these herbal supplements have components in them that could help, but put them through testing. Like, I'm pretty sure the supplement market in the US and the UK are similar in that they don't subject all the things in the bottles to testing. They just have a little line on the bottom that says, this has not been evaluated by the FDA. It's a similar thing in the UK.
Yeah.
And it's like, if they say that, it just means the claims are written so nebulously that who the fuck knows if it's going to do any good for you. And that's, and like I tell people, I'm like, look, if your doctor has told you to buy a certain supplement, like a certain vitamin supplement, it's probably because your body isn't absorbing it well enough. You have a specific condition for which you need it. That's fine. But fucking milk thistle is not going to save your failing liver. Like, it says, you know, supports liver. My major advisor from undergrad my chemistry advisor. She was 45 at the time. She just passed away last week from colon cancer, and it was along with colon cancer, the cancer had metastasized. There we go. There's the pronunciation to her liver, and she died in the end of liver failure. I promise you, if milk thistle worked for liver support, her doctor would have prescribed it, but he didn't. Okay, that's so. I mean, when I see people saying take milk thistle to support your liver, I'm like, no. No responsible doctor prescribes this, but I mean, these are people.
But Big Pharma is hiding that, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure Big Pharma really wanted my wonderful advisor to die. And she,
yes, because dead people keep paying. No, wait.
Here's the thing. If it worked, and I mean, recently, this came out last year, there was a berry, and I love this because there are so many. Many cures that come out of nature. There was a berry that was found in northern Australia that they derived a treatment from this berry for non-metastatic cancers. And they could apply it just topically. So far, it's been found to work in animals. They could apply it just topically to tumors on animals, and it just fucking dissolved the tumors. I mean, I think there's a more technical term for it than that. I'd written about it. I posted it about a little bit on my page, but they're not covering this up. They're like, this is great, let's research this more, because anything they can find that's going to help them fight cancer is wonderful. But cancer is not one thing. It's not a monolith. It's hundreds of diseases that act in a lot of different ways. Like, my professor got colon cancer. There are multiple types of colon cancer. She got a really aggressive one. There are multiple types of pancreatic cancer. Most pancreatic cancers kill you. A couple types are treatable. Like, it's when we hear a cure for cancer, that's not a thing that's ever going to happen, because there's not just one type of cancer. Like, some cancers, the main treatment is cutting out the tumor. Some types, like lymphoma, the main treatment is chemo. Like, some types, whenever you hear somebody say, oh, I got through cancer without chemo, it might be because they didn't really need chemo. They just needed surgery. So that's kind of one of the ways that people will sell, like, a nice little story about them beating cancer without, without drugs. It's like, yeah, maybe you didn't need them. So they sell this wonderful, heartwarming story of beating cancer with a vegan diet. It's probably because they didn't need anything other than to cut out the surgery. A lot of times chemo is adjunctive. So look really carefully when you hear that type of thing. Odds are that can trick somebody who really needs, beyond surgery, they need the chemo. That can trick somebody into not getting the care they need, and that really infuriates me.
It seems that 90% of the...
Sorry, go ahead. We'll go to Nathan there.
It seems like 90% of the sales pitch of the alternative medicine crowd is anecdotes. Like, this particular thing worked for me, this particular thing worked for my grandpa, and some other obscure relative, just stories of personal things that happened to themselves or people they know based about this thing they used. And that seems to be most of what they've got as far as reasons for why this thing works.
And anecdotes are so powerful, right? It's hard to argue with an anecdote. Number one, our brains aren't wired to get around that very well, because we see that proof right there in front of us. But we saw that my dog wanted, see, that my dog agrees with me. It's so hard to argue with seeing that proof right there that, that person was dying and now they're not. And somebody isn't always wired to be skeptical. Okay, where's the proof? What type of cancer was it? People also don't want to question someone who seems to have just been dying of cancer. That seems very rude. That breaks a couple of social contracts, so we won't do it. But it's just hard to get around that. But going back to the point of most of what they have is anecdotes. If they had more than anecdotes, it would be science. It would suddenly amount to something bigger. So, and they would they could join. They would no longer be alternative medicine. They would be medicine. And then the people on the alternative medicine side would call them shills. This would happen. If suddenly they had actual proof, Big Pharma, the big evil Big Pharma, would look into it and would sell it. And that's kind of why I think it's so disingenuous. They're like, Big Pharma's only interested in money. It's like, yeah, if your bullshit worked, Big Pharma would find the active ingredient, isolate it, put it through trials, and sell it. Why is this a thing that people even think, you know, is an argument? Like, that Big Pharma doesn't want to use it because it wouldn't make the money. It's like, if it works, it'd make the money. I don't really have a punchline for that.
Because it's easier to sell bullshit than science.
The best I can figure out with that argument is they're trying to say that if cancer is cured, and like you were saying, that doesn't make sense because they're lumping cancer into one big thing, but they're saying if cancer is cured, then they won't make any more money from treating patients. That's the best I can figure out is their argument, which of course is bullshit.
Well, that's kind of a specious argument because we're no longer selling iron lungs, and they had no problem giving out all those polio vaccines. They put the iron lung industry out of business. So they've had no problem putting certain industries out of business when they found cures for those diseases. So this whole theory that they want to keep the cancer industry in business is like, no, medical industry's been really happy to put certain industries out of business as soon as they find cures for things. It's just such a ridiculous argument. It's like cancer is really fucking hard to cure. So it's, but we do have cures. We found, and this is where I know this racket is just, they're scared of science because they say, you know, we want a cure for cancer. We want, you know, the big pharma's blocking a cure for cancer. They come up with the HPV vaccine, which not only prevents, you know, it prevents several strains of HPV, I believe, including the strain that causes warts. You're welcome to everyone. And then people go on and make all sorts of lies about it, including the wonderful lie from Michelle Bachmann. Did this make news over in the UK?
I don't know. What was it again?
It's Michelle Bachmann is a nut job American politician who, and this is a quote from her, so I'm sorry if any of the, if your viewers are offended by this word. She said that somebody came up to her at a campaign thing she was doing and told her that the HPV vaccine, and I quote, made her daughter retarded. I'm like, holy shit. Like, I was shocked that a politician would say that, and I was shocked that somebody would claim it and that she would just repeat it. So that was, it was just such an insane thing to hear. But the HPV vaccine is well-tested, well-documented to work. And the best thing is that now that people are starting to use it, we're seeing both cervical cancer rates go down and HPV transmission rates dropping, especially of the strains that cause cancer, cervical cancer and warts. So this is, it's one of those things that, like, you know, they say that they're covering up a cure for cancer when they come out with a treatment that, you know, with something that prevents cancer, just directly prevents cancer, they make up lies about it. So these are people that just don't trust something that they don't understand. And it's really, it's sad and it's scary, especially for people that are getting all this misinformation. My dog agrees. All right. Again.
Yeah, because over here, the main objection they had to the HPV was just, oh, it'll make women have more sex. And that was all they could say.
Good for them.
And I was like,
women should have more sex.
Yeah, I was just saying,
everyone should have more sex.
Yeah.
But yeah. It's not making anybody have any more sex than they were having or not having before. Like, it's, there's always an argument that you know, it's gonna make people, you know, fuck more. And they give this vaccine to teenagers. Teenagers are already awkward enough already and bad at having sex. I promise you, a shot is not gonna turn them into little Adonises and porn stars, okay? It's just gonna make them, when they do have sex, a little
which
more...
Which they will.
One thing, and I hope as parents, like, don't pass this off on the pharmaceutical companies. Don't pass off all your responsibilities as a parent on the pharmaceutical companies. Talk to them about, you know, being responsible with their bodies, with their hearts, with their minds. There's a lot more that goes into sex than just this one fucking disease, okay? So it was just this line of fear-mongering about this vaccine, and it was fucking ridiculous. So it's that, and I mean, God damn it, all these people that are like, teenagers are going to have sex. I'm like, the average age at which people have sex and have been having sex is like 16, 17. And that's been the average for decades now. So these are, you know, parents that know how old they were. And now they're like, oh, my kids are going to do the thing that I did. I'm getting the vapors. Just shut the fuck up and tell them how to use a condom, okay? And get them a little bit more prepared than you were. because I'm sure that these parents are afraid to talk about this with their kids. So please talk to your kids about sex. It's going to be squicky. It's going to be uncomfortable, but just talk about it.
Yeah. I kind of have sort of two in no way related anecdotes. One, when you were talking about how the people are basically just preying on the weak and the vulnerable, and they only ever have of these stories of, well, I heard from a guy this one time. I remember when my dad was on a cancer ward, and it was terminal. He knew he was going to kick the bucket. And there was this homeopathic medicine guy coming around saying, hey, do you want to try this? Oh, it's such a brilliant success rate. So many people have just had their cancer washed away, and now they're fantastic. My dad's sitting there, he's frail as fuck, he's yellow with jaundice, he's just tired, manages to push himself up off the bed, slowly make his way towards the guy and punch him in the face. And he was given, at that time, 6 months to live.
Oh my
and
god.
And lived for 18 in total, which means a valid source that punching homeopathic medicine salesmen will make you live longer.
I have gotten more death threats from homeopaths than from anyone else. It's because, I mean, I've made a handful of videos on homeopathy. I don't know if they've come across your desks or not, but I have a real problem with the homeopathic people, more even than the supplement people, than anyone else. It's there because they're literally selling nothing. It's sugar pills and it's water. And I mean, it's, you know, fine, sugar pills if you want a sugar rush, but like they're literally saying the water has a memory of the stuff that was once in it, so we can cure you with the memory of this. That's like saying that water that comes out of a sewage treatment plant has a memory of the shit that Johnny Depp shat into this. So you're really licking Johnny Depp's ass when you're drinking water. That's not how any of this works, okay? That's just not how this fucking works. So, I mean, I've done a few demos on, you know, for my YouTube channel, showing that I can take literally an entire bottle of homeopathic sleeping pills, and I didn't need my stomach pumped. I didn't even get drowsy. And the best part was these nutty homeopaths, you know, were like, oh, it didn't work because you didn't take it right. I'm like, what was I? Some of them said I wasn't supposed to put it in my hand, because that disrupted like the aura of the I'm like, if I took a Vicodin, I can just take it. I could even cut it in two and it's still fine. I can smash the motherfucker and it still works. Like, there's none of this, there's no aura. It's just gonna work. Let's see, someone said that because I took too many, because you're supposed to take less, so it's more. I'm like, does that mean I should have put it down the street for me and stared at it for a little while, and that would have like gotten the aura of it into my system? Like, it's, then they said because I took it with a Diet Coke, because we all know I have a bit of a Diet Coke addiction, that it, today I'm drinking Diet Dr. Pepper. I'm swaying from, because I have no brand loyalty, but there was they said that because I took it with a Diet Coke, the caffeine was undid the sleeping pills. I'm like, 50. I took 50 of them. If I did that with two Ambien, I don't know what the brand name is over in England, Zolpidem, I think. But if I'd done that with two prescription sleeping pills, I would have been out like a light. It doesn't matter if I'd taken a Red Bull, I would have been out. Because prescription sleeping pills, they have real fucking medicine in them. But these things were sugar. And all
was it,
of the
was it Calm's Forte?
Calm's Forte. It's
because it's, caffeine is the ingredient in it, so that's it's, you know, because it does the opposite.
Oh my god! But they're diluted.
If you dilute caffeine, it becomes sleeping agent because it does the opposite. That like cures like, you know. That's,
so
I think
crazy.
That's absolutely ridiculous. So apparently caffeine doesn't work. That's they're saying caffeine cancels out. About caffeine, yeah, that's homeopath logic for you.
The funny thing is, it was funny because last year it was wonderful. I got to go to Australia for a speaking engagement. It's for Australia's National Science week. And one of the last things I got to do was in Tasmania. I was speaking with another really wonderful scientist, Dr. Susie Wiles, at the Tasmania National Museum and Art Gallery. And we were talking about, you know, just the same type of stuff we're talking about here. And they told us we could swear, which was great. It was an adult audience. We were just chit-chatting about all kinds of different things. And at the end, somebody got up and started saying, you know, big pharma is bad. And, you know, Susie and I were trying to be nice. And we're like, you know what, big pharma, yeah, it does some bad things. And I even gave some examples because big pharma fucks up. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to disagree with that because, yeah,
big pharma. Asshole that raised the cost Martin on Shkreli. HIV medicine, yeah, by, was it 5,000% or whatever?
Yeah, he's, yeah, kind of the biggest asshole in the universe. Like, if you see him, I was about to joke, if you see him, throw rocks at him, but don't throw rocks at him, please. You know, just give him a dirty look, please. I'm sure it'll hurt him and his zillions of dollars. It'll make him feel really bad about himself. He's like the Donald Trump of the pharmaceutical industry, really. Just, he's like, what are you gonna do, hurt my day? So, but yeah, he anyways, but you know, it's, I said to the guy, I'm like, yeah, both of us said pharmaceutical industries screw up, but more, they are helping more people than the homeopaths and the supplement industry. And then the guy flew off the handle and was all, homeopathy is good and homeopathy works through vibrational energy. I'm like, that's not even how, I'm like, you're misunderstanding,
that's not even a thing.
Oh yeah. So I mean, let's see. Another thing that happened was because I was touring Australia for National Science Week. I was in my last stop was in Adelaide. And earlier in the week, this woman, this crazy homeopath who had been charged with like harming her patients, like, and I mean, they'd gotten infections from her stuff. She'd been under investigation. They put up a thing, like she put up a thing on her Facebook page threatening my life for my first homeopathy video. It was homeopath Monica or something. She just went nuts on me. And I was like, oh my God, I'm going to be in the same town as her. It's the one time I'm in this tiny town across the, or not tiny town, Adelaide's not tiny, but it's the one time I'm in this town across the planet from where I live. And this woman put a death threat out to me. So, I mean, the homeopaths get really, really cranky. I would say crankier than the vegans even. I think most of the time vegans just want to not eat animals and be left alone. But then there are a lot of really loud ones in the movement. So
I think I have the perfect response to any homeopath. The opposite. Basically, the more you dilute something, the stronger it gets. It has the opposite effect, yada, yada, yada. Take a bottle of vodka, get a drop of vodka, and get 20 liters of water. Put the drop in the 20 liters and, yep, drink it, and you're just fucked. If that's the way it works.
No, that would make you sober.
I have a report of, if you're dying of a hangover, do the same thing. Surely it should work.
Well, it's like I tell people, do you want the homeopathic preparation of morphine when you've had surgery, or do you want the full dose? I want the full dose. I want to be so fucked up that I don't remember that I was even going in for surgery that day. So it's, but I think people forget that you know, the way that they want to exist in this world where the homeopathic stuff is fine, and that, you know, medicine can be, they're like, well, you know, you have your different fields of medicine. You have Eastern medicine and you have homeopathic medicine. You have I'm like, no, it's all science. It's all what science is and what science isn't. And you have to be able to prove all of it or it's bullshit. Like, it's, you know, show me something you can prove or don't, you know, don't claim it.
What's the old saying, what do you call home remedies that work? Fucking medicine.
Yeah, I think it was Tim Minchin. What do you call alternative medicine that works? Medicine.
Yeah.
So it's, I love that one from Tim. It was funny, when I was in Australia, and this was the one of the most wonderful things that happened, because occasionally I'll get emails saying, I read your book, your article on the Food Babe. And I changed my mind. I came over from the dark side, and I don't get those often, but the best letter the best little nugget from this that ever happened, when I was in Australia, someone came up to me and said, from checking out Tim Minchin and from reading your blog. I was at school for being a naturopath, and now the kid, I'm still friends with him on Facebook, Jamie, he is now in school for biomed. I'm like, ah! So occasionally people do, you know, change their minds in incredible ways from checking out what we're doing. And this is why I always want people to do more blogging on this. And kind of, at this point, it's a game of drowning out all the nuttery, because it's so, they for a while just, no one was countering it. It just seemed like, you know, anytime someone said natural is better, there was no one there to say, hey, wait a second, polio's natural. Like no one was, there were no dissenting voices. So it's important to be out there saying your piece, because it's kind of a battle of the Google wars. It's getting out there and winning, winning being the top person when you're searching for one of these results, because people are getting, when people are looking for good information on this, they're getting cut off at the pass. You know, you're Googling are vaccines safe? And out of the top 10 Google results, I think over half of them are bullshit. And, you know, how much searching should a parent have to do to come to good results? That's the, that's the crux of this, is how much searching will somebody do to find good information when they're, you know, a busy mother of three who just wants to know if something's killing their kid or not?
Would it not, I'd love to see, and I know it will never happen, but it would be brilliant if it was like most commonly debunked things searched on Google, you know, like do vaccines cause autism, that sort of a thing. And if Google themselves stepped in, and whenever someone searches that, it just displays across the entire screen, no, you idiot.
Oh man, and the sad thing is they're at the whim of how SEO works, and they're at the whim of how people like Mike Adams step in and SEO the fuck out of their nutty websites like Natural News and make it rise to the top. Like when my article went viral for a while, my article on Bonnie Hari was at the top with the Gawker search results. Now, when you Google the food babe blogger is full of shit, the top number one search result is her, is I believe her response to it. Then is David Gorski's article on it at Science Blogs or at Science Based Medicine. Then is my article. And it's just because of how SEO works. Even though my article has the most hits, just because they SEO'd the crap out of it, that's how it works. So it's search engine optimization runs the internet right now.
Yeah. All right. I was just going to ask, have you actually incurred the wrath of Mike Adams yet? Has he responded to you personally?
Yes. Anyway?
All right. Yeah.
He has, I believe it's on Truth Wiki, there's an article about me, and it's funny because it starts off by saying she's not even worth this blog entry. Then it's like a 10,000-word entry ripping everything about me apart. It says that I'm 40 pounds overweight. I'm 5 pounds overweight. Okay, 5, motherfucker. But it's
and
a
how
massive...
is that relevant?
Well, what? Yeah, exactly.
Start with an ad hominem.
Yeah, I mean, it's nutty. It says that I promote cigarettes and alcohol. Now, they took this. Yeah, it's. I'm like, I'm telling kids, smoke up, motherfuckers. Just pod. But it's. I live in California. The funny thing is I really don't drink. I have Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. It's just, as I like to call it, it's Gumby disorder. Would you guys like a demonstration?
Yeah.
Does do body things freak anybody out?
Yeah.
All right. So, most people, when they stretch one of their arms, they stop about here. Mine keeps going.
Oh, right.
So like, I look like I've been doing yoga for like decades. I can bend over, kiss my kneecaps without warming up. I'm ultra mobile. The bad thing is it also means I pop things out. Like I have a rib that's been popped halfway out of it's been popped out of the cartilage for a little while now, and it fucking hurts. So that's another, that's when one doctor will think that the headache is this really rare one. Another one will think that it's connected to, whatchamacallit, the Ehlers-Danlos. So unfortunately the autoimmune issues tend to cluster, so that's fun, but they are ultra unhealthy on these things. I'm like, no, I have a health condition that I'm taking care of, and you have to be on top of it when you have a health disorder. I'm out there living my life. I'm traveling all the time for work. I'm obviously not unhealthy if I'm going rock climbing, doing yoga, and cycling. This is not, these are not the behaviors of someone that's that unhealthy. But see, in the blog entry from Mike Adams, I said I was promoting cigarettes and alcohol. I have one video in which I am smoking a cigarette. I'm not a smoker. And drinking wine. My point of that video was both the cigarette and the wine were organic.
Yeah.
I'm like, look, it's a healthy treat because it's organic. Oh, you guys thought I was going to be recommending an apple or a salad or anything other than cigarettes and liquor. And it was to point out that just because something's organic doesn't mean it's healthy. So he talks the entire time about how I'm pro-chemical and my brain's probably addled with chemicals and I'm fat. And I'm like, you have to be fucking kidding me. Like, I've lost 90 pounds in my life. I've admittedly gained about 20 back, but fuck it. I've kept 70 off. I'm quite happy about this. I'm pro-chemical. I only eat GMOs. I'm like, I live on like salad most of the, I eat a lot of veggies. Like, what the, anyways, okay, fine. And Diet Dr. Pepper.
You mean to be pro-chemical?
Yeah, and it's like, I don't, like, here's the thing. I am pro-chemical, but only in the way that I want people to understand what a chemical is. And I want people to understand that there are, like, the dose is in, or the poison is in the dose. Like, it's like, you can have one or so bottles of Diet Dr. Pepper and it's fine. You should drink a lot of water, and you should, you know, if you want other things than that to drink, unsweetened tea is fine. You can have a cup of coffee. Don't have 27 cups of coffee. Be, you know, like, dose is important. Like, this is what people really don't understand. What all people hear are chemicals. They're bad. And, like, people will hear something is chemical free. I'm like, oh, I'm glad you're living in a vacuum.
Yeah. Like,
people are,
what
and
was
it's
it,
like,
some, was it Cal that you mentioned someone was selling chemical-free salt?
Yeah. There's Himalayan chemical-free and GMO-free salt, which
it's
is
like,
that's not, I could, yeah, I know, I can just see kids right now.
Is it the Himalayan pink salt?
Yeah, the pink salt. I can just,
has anybody,
the irony is that that stuff's from Pakistan, from an area that's technically not in the Himalayas.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Because I remember Kitch, we told Dr. Perlak about that, and he was just, what are you two guys on about?
I think we broke him that day when we told him that.
Anyway, carry on, Kitch.
No,
does anybody know about Penn and Teller when they went to the college campus, or they hired a woman to go to the college campus and have students sign a petition to ban dehydrogen monoxide?
Yes.
And people didn't even bother to ask what it was. They just signed the petition to ban it, not knowing that it was water.
No, some people did question it in their defense, because they showed at the end of the episode some people were questioning it. But I mean, yeah, Penn and Teller on bullshit, they did, they've done a few things like that, and I love it. But here's the thing, there's another name for it, a fairly unknown name, Oxidane. That's kind of one of the IUPAC names for water. So at some point, I want to repeat that test, asking people to ban Oxidane. And it's such a, she did it so well. She's like, it's in baby food, it's in pesticides, it's all over the place. It's coming up in the grass now, and it's like, oh yeah, she did a good job. Like, she did a great job on. And I mean, if you don't know any, now that's the point. Is like, she did a perfect job of showing how people like the food babe use deceptive bullshit to, you know, to troll people. And the sad thing is that this troll, this, you know, paid actor, perfectly demonstrated how the food babe works. Like, and she was acting. How sad is that?
But would you say that food babe is, does she believe her own bullshit?
You know, I can never say what's in someone's mind.
No, but
that's a hard call.
That's true. But
if I had to put a guess, and this is just throwing it out there, I think she might have started out with good intentions, but now I'm guessing that she just looks at this as, you know, how can I rile this up and make money off of it? Like, it's because, I mean, it wouldn't surprise me, but I mean, I've heard some rumors that about why this all started, and why she really got into blogging, and it's not the story that she tells people. But I can't say any of those publicly because pretty nasty. But no, she, as to if she really believes it or not, I don't know. I mean, I went to a book signing of hers once. And I mean, I've only been in the same building as her twice. And this sounds kind of creepy because all this was before the website took off. And I was just trying to figure, you know your enemy. Like one of them was, I'd only had a website for, I think, 2 or 3 weeks. I saw she was speaking. I'm like, okay, let's go. Like the website was growing really fast. I was getting 1,000 new followers a week. I'm like, well, let's go investigate this. She was speaking at the LA Green Festival. I'm like, all right, let's, and my coworkers at my, you know, at the pesticide company I worked at, they loved that I was doing this. They're like, this is great. You're communicating that what we do is safe. Well, go check it out. I got to the LA Green Festival a little too late to see her, but I trolled every booth that was saying we sell non-toxic stuff. One of them was selling like a little linen spray that was made with isopropanol, which can shut down your kidneys. So I pointed this out and they're like, get away. I got kicked out of like 4 booths for pointing out they were full of shit. I was not well liked there. But they had a booth from the LA Animal Shelter was there. I adopted my puppy that day. So she was they're telling people that scientists were evil shills. I adopted a puppy, so that was my yeah. So evil scientist. I adopted a doggy. He still pees on the floor because he was a stray and he came with issues. But other than that, he's really cute. So let's see. The other time I was in the same room as her. It was because her book had come out. And of course, where are you going to go to promote your book than to the center of all bullshit, Orange County? Now at the time. Now I live in LA, which is likewise the center of bullshit, but I like LA quite a bit. I was living in Orange County. I was living in Anaheim, and she went to Laguna Beach. Now, I love Laguna Beach. It's pretty, but it's the home of all rich, bored people. So, of course, that's where Bonnie Hari went to market her book. She was at a tiny little bookstore, and it was packed. And people were asking her, you know, how do you eat well on the road? And she's like, yeah, my husband and I ordered takeout. And I'm like, Bonnie Hari orders takeout? What? Did she slip and say that? That's a thing that the food babe does. How that might make her shit stink though. That's a thing that Vani can't do. That might make her size 2s tight. How can she handle that? Like, and I'm processing it. And then someone in the audience asked, they're like, you ordered takeout? And she's like, yeah, but that's why we have our green juice the next day, because it flushes out the toxins. I'm like, she knows she's full of shit. That was no. No, 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 no. Like, on some level, like, I know she's too smart to buy all of this. She's not stupid. She's not crazy. She's full of, like, there was a thing from George Carlin a while ago saying some people are stupid, some people are crazy, and some people are full of shit. Bonnie is full of shit. Yeah. And I think she knows that this type of full of shit is a great money-making operation, and it's like, as long as she keeps on just shoveling out the shit, people are gonna keep putting it into nice little jars and putting a cute little Pinterest themed like little macrame thing on it and saying it was Bonnie's shit. I love it. So I think that's the crux of it.
And like, I think she knows she takes it too far sometimes too, because some of her blogs sometimes disappears from the internet. Unfortunately, some people are able to cash save it before it disappears completely. But the blog about, for example, the blog about pilots bogarting all the oxygen in airplanes.
Oh, we freeze paged that motherfucker.
Yeah. She also complained there was nitrogen in the air on airplanes as well.
And because of that, now whenever I fly, like, and it's just become a joke on the page now. Whenever I fly for work, I always take a quick selfie and like because and say, guys, I don't know how I'm going to survive this flight with all the nitrogen in the air. And now I've gotten to the point where I have to make the pictures funny because just a picture of me smiling on the airplane is boring. So the last time I was like clawing at the window, going, guys, help me, the nitrogen. it's become like the joke every time I fly. Have to make a fucking joke about this because I'm like, at least it was great set up for a way to get engagement up on my page. Yeah. But
now when something like that happens,
I have to say, I love the idea of some like first time flyer terrified of their first, they're like, oh god, I'm I've never been on a long haul flight, and then you're there clawing at the window taking a picture.
Well, luckily I'm a really chatty person on the air. As you can tell, I can't shut the fuck up. So I own it. But like I'll chit chat with the person that I'm next to and say, this is a thing for my website, so that they know that I'm not, you know, that I'm only a little crazy. But it's like I feel like I have to explain when I'm sitting there taking a selfie, you know, of me doing a goofy thing on an airplane. I'm like, this is for my website. I promise you, I'm just a touch crazy. But I know it's a weird thing to do, to be like sitting there going, like when taking a selfie doing that, but and sitting there trying to get a, you know, I'm like, I have to get the light in, I have to look like, but it's like, I take enough pictures that I put on my website with like no makeup and with my hair messy that I don't care if I look good. I just want the picture to be funny. So that's the goal. I really don't take the babe part of Cy Babe all that seriously.
It's just to ask, because we've covered both, who do you think is actually more dangerous between Vanny and Mike?
Because
I've been trying to debate this myself in my head, because I would tend to go more with Vanny, because she seems to be more active and getting out to kind of destroy and annoy people, whereas Mike just seems to do it from behind the screen almost. He's not as active in getting out to get to people.
Mike, I would say, it seems so crazy that people don't take him seriously. The problem with people like Vani Hari and with Dr. Oz is that they seem credible. And that shred of credibility makes people like your soccer moms, makes people like, you know, the people that aren't crazy. When people who aren't nuts take you seriously, that's the problem. So Mike Adams just seems so fucking nuts that no one's listening to him. Like, he's nutty enough that you can go, no, look at this. Look at how fucking crazy this all is. And people go, oh, and back away slowly. But like Vani Hari just seems sane enough. And she got just like, luckily now she doesn't get any traction in mainstream media. You're welcome. But she, like that was the biggest accomplishment of that, because she still has a million followers. She still has a career. But, you know, she doesn't get featured on CNN anymore. She doesn't get, like, she used to get videos put on Yahoo Health, and she used to be able to write, like, op-eds for the New York Times. Nobody gives her mainstream media press anymore, and that was the biggest thing that the article did, and I will take fucking credit for that. But, like, there were other journalists that had written about her before, so I wasn't the only one who was out there writing. It was just this style of writing was able to touch a big cultural nerve, and it made people go, ah, we shouldn't be doing this anymore, this is bad. So if I see another person who's getting traction like her, don't worry, I'll write again. Like, I'm still, you know, out there writing, but like there will be another mass takedown like this again if there needs to be. I'm sure it'll be coming, but like the big difference between Vani and Mike, and even people like Mercola, is that Vani was, she, you know, it's kind of Icarus. She flew too high. She wanted to have a television show. She was all over mainstream press. The others kind of stayed in their little hidey holes on the internet, and they weren't trying to be mainstream. She was taking her bullshit all over the place, and we had to clean it up.
Okay, guys.
Shall we do chat room questions?
Chat room questions. I'm trying to decide who to. Pumpkin, you can do the chat room questions.
Oh, fucking joy.
Oh, my. Anything fun or scary?
Well, the first question is, do you feel bad for making people flood Volta's email with cat memes?
Wait, what?
Do you feel bad for making people flood Volta's email with cat memes?
I don't know if feel bad is the right thing. I was both... because here's the thing, in private chat with me and Kevin, because Kevin and I were good friends, so this was not like, this isn't something that I just launched on him without talking to him about it first, and like this was something that we discussed first. What I do feel bad about is how many cat memes showed up, and the fact that people didn't follow directions. Neither of us anticipated that, because we said send cat memes, please, just memes, don't send text. And I wish I'd been a little bit more explicit on saying, do not fucking send text. Whatever you do, don't get any bright ideas about sending text. Because a couple of people sent a few chapters of War and Peace. For fuck's sake, people, there's a reason that we said just send the memes, because the reason that the memes were a good idea was because the lawyer wouldn't have to read through it. It was just, they could just click done. It wouldn't take that long. But when you send 30, you know, a couple chapters of War and Peace with, you know, my name interspersed through it just to make sure that it meets the criteria for this search, that means the lawyer has to work through it. Now, I get it. It's just coming out of, like, it's a drop. Now, I know he sits there and complains about it being, you know, out of the school's fund. And overall, it's a drop in the fucking bucket for, you know, for the school's lawyers' funds. However, like, it's, you know, please, you know, if we say just send cat memes, don't get creative. Send the fucking cat memes, okay? Now, the good thing is, like, Kevin and I were talking about it later. Number one, he said, you know, I was a little shocked at first, but he's like, it really did make, he said, he told me, you know, when we were chatting about it, he's like, this really did make my day. The fact that, you know, it's whether or not people sent them because they were supportive of me, or, you know, because they wanted in on the fun, whatever it was, the fact that people the fact that this many people emailed me in support, he was touched, and he was so happy that there was this much interaction and this much support for the cause. So I don't think there was any harm overall. And I know some people were worried about there being fallout from this, but we already have a couple of plans in place. And I will, if anyone is mad about this, if the jerks, if the woo-mongers try to blame anyone, I will be taking full blame, because it was my blog entry about it. And it was nothing that Kevin did. So I think it's, at the end of this, if anyone's upset, it will be much ado about nothing. But Kevin got a big kick out of it, and he was very happy with some of the really funny ones. So it's, you guys are funny motherfuckers.
All right, Pumpkin, next one.
But what was that all about? I know it was something like Vani Hari demanded that his public email or something like that, but...
Yeah.
What was the point with the cat memes? So, was it just to make fun of her or something like that?
Well, there were two things that happened here. This is the second time she sent him a FOIA request. Now, the first one was for search terms that included her name. It was like for Vani Hari, Food Babe, Monsanto, Babe, whatever. And this is the second time she's FOIA'd him. And it was for search terms including my name, either Yvette Guinevere or Yvette D'Entremont, and everyone that she knows Kevin is friends with who have ever written about him. And I'm like, oh, this is personal, bitch. So the cat memes, we basically wanted an email with a picture of a cat that also had Vani's name and basically anything that she might FOIA him for that also had, and also to put my name in there, because she has to pay, like, even though you have to pay the lawyers for their time, she has to pay for every sheet that she gets sent, and it's 15 cents a page. So it's like, fine, you can have the pages, but it's gonna cost you. So this is kind of, it's kind of adding to the pile a little bit. So this is also going to be prohibitive of her trying to FOIA anything with me in it in the future. And we also told people to put the terms Vani, Babe, and Monsanto into the emails, partially to be prohibitive of her doing this again. And it's like, look, there's nothing to hide. It's that we're going to make you think twice about harassing a scientist. And it's like, he sent her everything. There's been nothing to hide. There's been nothing to hide for a while, but, you know, we're just going to slap you with an extra $1,000, like 7,000 emails at 15 cents a page comes out to about $1,000. So, but I just thought it was interesting that people sent them all of these pictures. And it's ridiculous. Like, the other point of this is that FOIA desperately needs reform. I think that people need, like, and I get it, these are public employees. So technically the way that works is that the emails are already owned by the state. But on some level, I feel like this violates the Fourth Amendment, protection from illegal searches and seizures. So I feel like there should be cause before somebody can go looking for these through these emails first. So I hope at some point there's FOIA reform.
Why do you think she went after Kevin in the first place? Because
she went after Kevin.
Because I just thought there's so many bigger targets she could have gone after. You know, like I say, I love Kevin and his work, but you think there's so many other bigger names she could have attacked rather than Kevin.
Well, it's partially because Kevin has, you know, spoken out against her quite publicly. But when she went to speak at University of Florida, where Kevin speaks, or Kevin teaches, and when she did that, Kevin did a write-up on what, you know, in his blog on her little speaking engagement, and said that, you know, she hadn't stayed to answer questions contrary to her contract. And she, there were a lot of, you know, there were a lot of things that went wrong, you know, with her speaking engagement. And she was not happy about the fact that Kevin spoke out about this. And Kevin is, you know, a tireless, both crusader for science, both he's very, a very staunch advocate for genetic for GMOs, and he's, you know, he's a very good science communicator who speaks out against her. So of course, when people started FOIAing, when people started FOIAing, he was a target of this, and he was targeted not just by Vonnie, but he was targeted first by USRTK, this nutty anti-GMO group. So after they went through his emails, Vonnie was like, she just wanted in on the game, and she's like, "Fuck it, I'm gonna pretend I'm doing activism," and FOIA'd him too. So it's all this huge game to try to discredit really good scientists. I mean, 40 scientists have been served with FOIA requests at this point, and it's not because they've done anything wrong. It's because they've spoken out in favor of GMOs at this point. And it's horrifying that this is just a thing that they can do. Like last year, Dr. Shelley Maguire, a breast milk researcher, conducted a really well-researched study to show that that there was no Roundup in breast milk. And it was verified by two outside labs. This nutty group that is just scared to death of Roundup FOIA'd her to try to find if she was paid off by Monsanto. Like this woman was not actively involved in social media campaigns. She wasn't one of the people that was out speaking out against, you know, Food Babe. She was just a really quiet researcher, and now she gets death threats. Like, it's been nuts to watch the type of environment it is. So it's why I do what I do, because I have a thick skin and I don't take shit. So I see the scientists getting harassed, and it horrifies me.
And what's next with Food Babe? Babe's plans, I'm sure we can expect that her and people like her are going to sift through the emails and look for passages to selectively pick out and string together and make sentences to make it look like they're doing something dastardly.
Oh yeah, that's exactly what we're expecting and what we're planning for is what are they going to take out of context to try to make it look like Kevin Folta has been planning something horribly nefarious with me and with all the other people that he's that's on this list, and we just are you know, bracing for whatever's going to happen. So that's how that works when you get FOIA'd. And I mean, this a FOIA request can only happen to a public employee. So there's no risk of this happening to someone who's not I can't be FOIA'd unless one of you works for a public office in the U.S. You can't be FOIA'd, but they're basically looking, like, because Vonnie would love to search through my emails, she put Covens and Apathy and her co-authors on a book about her and other types of fear mongers. She put them on the list, basically, and she put Dr. Joe Schwartz, another really good scientist who'd written about her, on the list. Basically, anyone who she thought might have said something mean about her, she put them all onto this list to see what she could see about their emails. And it's just, it's like, how can I find ways to say these people have, you know, done nefarious things about me? And it's like, it's so narcissistic to think that the U.S. taxpayer should pay for a lawyer to go through emails about you. It's ridiculous.
Okay. Pumpkin, can you carry on with the chat room questions?
I suppose if I have to.
I would do it, but I don't have it, so.
What is your opinion on ketogenic diets?
Oh, ketogenic diets. I think they can work for some people. I know I spoke to a registered dietitian last week that said, you know what, if it works for you, do it. I don't know if they're great long-term. It's because I believe that they cut out some food groups that are wonderful for you, because I think that, you know, I hope that if you go on a ketogenic diet, eventually you reintroduce things like fruits and grains. But I think long term, if you were able to maintain a healthy weight, I would much rather see somebody, like if your weight is impacting your health and your life, and to the point where you're like, I just need to do something about this. I'd much rather see somebody long term on a ketogenic diet and able to maintain a healthy weight than not. So there's no one perfect human diet. I think it's just whatever works for you to maintain a weight that you and your doctor are happy with and that you're healthy at. So, but that being said, I still think paleo is stupid. Even if you lost weight, I still think it's silly.
Okay, Pumpkin, is there any more after that? I can't remember.
The final question is, are you going to be swearing at Reason Rally?
I actually have a really, really, I'm not doing my typical thing at Reason Rally. I'm going to be talking about my professor who just died. And she was, even though she was, a PhD in synthetic organic chemistry, and she was my major advisor, I didn't even know this until I found out that she was dying. Here's the saddest part. I friended her on Facebook, like after Nexus last, or around Nexus last week. Just to be like, hey, remember when I majored in college or double majored in chemistry and theater and I was going to be Vet the Science Dudette, and instead I'm Cy Babe, so close enough. And I finally met Bill Nye, and I had a picture of me with Bill Nye, and I was so proud and I wanted to show her. And there she was on her Facebook page with all the blue ribbons because she was dying of colon cancer. And she died a week later, right after I friended her. And I knew, like, long term that she was, you know, very quietly religious. And, like, the Reason Rally, a lot of times in the atheism communities, we speak out about, against, like, the Ray Comforts and the Kirk Camerons of the world. We don't talk about the wonderful professors that are very quietly going to church for an hour a week and saying a prayer once in a while. We don't talk about those people. We talk about religion as though it's the big thing, but I think I think people are much bigger than the sum of their parts, and I think we're much more defined by the things that unite us than these small things that divide us. And it's a humanist thing to reach out to a friend when they're in pain like that. And she was asking for prayers, and even though I'm an atheist, when she asked for prayers, I didn't suddenly think there was a God, and I didn't suddenly think that me saying a prayer was going to do anything, but a friend who did a lot for me in my life asked for a prayer, so I said one, and that's what I'm going to talk about, and I don't know how it's going to go over, and I'm scared, and I'm afraid that I'm not going to get through it without crying, because I'm still kind of horrified that she died at 45 and left two kids behind, and I never got to see her, you know, I didn't get to see her again, and I wanted to tell her how much of an impact she had on my life and how well I'm doing because of her, and it's been a really rough week, and I'm gonna go up and give a talk that's dedicated to someone that did so much for me, and she was religious, and I think that it's important to remember that while we're trying to tell religious people, hey, we're atheists and we're not eating babies, it's important to remember that religious people have done a lot for us too.
All right,
because there are friends. So,
was there any more chat room questions here, Pumpkin?
No, but I'm going to ask the question that I've always asked and never finally got a distinct answer for. How do you science?
How do I science?
How do you science?
Preferably naked with a good lube.
Does that satisfy you, Pumpkin?
That is the best possible answer I could have gotten to that question.
I was hoping the lube was right on the coffee table, but I think we brought it to the bedroom the other night.
Excuse me.
I'm hoping everyone's blushing and a little wet. Like, is that what you were hoping for?
Well, until you said it, I didn't realize it was exactly what I was looking for.
But now you realize it was just that.
And the answer to the YouTube song, I still haven't found what I'm looking for. You found what the fuck you were looking for. I do what I can. So it's if any of you guys are ever in Burbank, California, look me up. We will hang. It'll be a good time.
I'm just a stone's throw away in Southern Oregon, so bit more than a stone's throw.
I was about to say, I know my boyfriend and I are road tripping up to Washington later this year for a friend's wedding. So we'll be almost in your neighborhood. We'll be heading.
Yeah, I'm in Ashland, which is a big woo part of the southern part / northern part of California / Oregon.
Yeah. Oh dear.
Because we keep trying to ask Vance Crowe to send Nathan a Monsanto t-shirt, and we want Nathan to get a camera and walk through a Whole Foods wearing it. You said there wasn't a Whole Foods, but there was a next best thing there, wasn't there?
Natural grocers.
Oh, right. That'd be just as good.
It's funny. I actually go to Sprouts fairly often because I have, again, if I heard somebody listing off all the things that I had wrong and I didn't know that they weren't full of shit and that wasn't a hypochondriac, I'd be like, you're a full of shit hypochondriac. But like, I also have celiac disease because life didn't want me to have anything that tastes good. But so I shop at Sprouts mainly because they have a really good gluten-free section. And while I'm walking through there, I'm like, this is bullshit. Oh, okay, I have the gluten-free thing that I need. And it's like, occasionally I see a thing in there that tastes like magic and is gluten-free and it makes me so happy. But like, there are so many things that are just bullshit. And I'm like, oh, there are people that think this is just the healthiest thing ever because of all the stupid fucking things in the label. And I always tell people, look at the front of the label versus the back of the label. Like, just because it says, you know, organic, vegan, paleo friendly, all that good stuff, look at how many calories are on the back. The front of the label and the back of the label do not match up, I promise you. So it's a silly fucking place to shop at.
My favorite of all time has to be picking up a bag of like sea salts for throwing into hot pot.
But if you like it, I'll do it. So there are some tasters, some super tasters that say that they can taste the difference. And Alton Brown swears by kosher salt. So I think the textures can make a difference in cooking.
Yeah. There was one thing this can finish the show off, because it's something you've gone through and I'm going through it right now, because I've lost quite a lot of weight myself. I've lost about 50 pounds so far since September. And it's just
congratulations.
Are you ever shocked at the sheer amount of woo that you will get thrown at you when you tell people you're on a diet? Do this, really works. My sister, it was actually my sister, she sent me for the cinnamon. So I heard of that one. You put cinnamon in everything and this is supposed to, the pounds are just supposed to fall off. But are you just ever surprised by that? Like the second they hear you're on a diet and you're just bombarded with it almost from well-meaning folk.
They mean well, yeah. But it's like they suddenly want you to lose weight their way. And it's a strange thing. It's like, no, I'm losing. That's great that you have a way that you lost weight or that you heard of to lose weight, but I'm losing my weight my way. I'm doing a good job. I'm going to keep doing it this way. I'm like, if I need help, I'll come to you. And like, I was losing weight just by, you know, cutting calories and getting my ass to the gym a lot. And like, however you want to lose weight, do that. Like, there's your weight loss, like your thing is okay. Like, it's like, unless you're losing weight by sticking your finger down your throat and like crying over the cheesecake you're not eating, like maybe you should find another way to lose weight if that's your method. But like, don't, you know, like if someone's losing weight by a healthy means, like, you know, maybe keep your advice to yourself. Like, it's, you know, it's just say, you know, I'm supportive of you. I'm glad you're doing something that makes you feel, you know, healthier and feel better about yourself. That's a good thing to say when someone's losing weight. And like, the funny thing is, women were kind of mean to me when I was losing weight. Like, you go through years of people being mean to you because you're fat. Like, I think that's more so with women than with men. And then women were really bitchy to me about my weight loss because people tie you in, especially with more, I think more with women, tie you to your weight. Because you hear people talk about fat chicks, and it's like, you're no longer just, your weight. You're no longer you. You're just a fat chick. I'm like, I have a master's degree. I have a sense of humor. I'm a Red Sox fan. Don't hold that against me. I there are a lot of things that I have here other than just, you know, the fact that my ass doesn't fit into a size 6. And then, like, when I lost the weight, ex-boyfriends came out of the woodwork. Like, it was strange. I'm like, I'm still the same weirdo. Like, I'm tinier. Like, that's all that happened here. And it was strange how people treated me differently through the weight loss. And at the end of it, I'm like, I'm still me. I wear a different size. So people are very weird about how they treat people and weight. And we put a lot of, I think we put a lot on how we connect a human being to their size. And it's like, I don't buy into the health at every size movement, but I do buy a lot into body acceptance because I think that people need to stop linking a human to how much to their body fat percentage.
Yeah,
because
health
at every size.
There's other ways that are just not good for losing weight. And I'm not going to say, like, you know, oh, the Atkins diet is always terrible. But if you're like cutting off one of your legs and taking heroin, and that may not be the healthiest of ways to lose weight.
Yeah. So, I'll agree.
Yeah, because I've had kind of some of the same experiences you've had over the past year. I've actually had to cut some friends off because of their attitude towards me once I started losing weight. Because there were some who just said, oh, you've just become so obsessed. You're obviously depressed. You know, just don't bother. You'll be happier the way you were and all this. You know, those weird, and it was the same folk who were onto me to lose weight. And then once you started doing it, they resisted it so badly. I just couldn't figure out some people with it. But they were kind of outnumbered by the encouragement I got. So.
Oh, yeah. People either want you to stay fat your whole life or stay skinny your whole life. But if you change, if you gain weight from being a skinny person, they're like, man, you've gained weight, so you have to change something. Or if you lose weight, like, they're worried about your health. Like, I'm like, you were never worried about my health when I was fat. Like, suddenly you're worried about my, like, the first thing someone says to you when you're losing weight is, well, are you doing it healthfully? I'm like, no, I'm doing it by chewing glass. Like, like, what did you expect me to say? Like, it's like every single time, pardon, I'm drinking Diet Dr. Pepper, so I'm belching. I should have probably gone with water. But I needed my caffeine this morning and I didn't make coffee, so I apologize. But, like, people are very strange about how they treat you with weight loss. And it's like, you know what, you just have to say, like, the easiest thing to do about it is to be quiet and not bring it up the whole time. Because if you talk about it, people are going to get on you. And it's such a strange phenomenon. It's like everyone wants someone to lose weight. And then when they do it, like, all they do is get on you about it. I'm like, could you not... Could you just be supportive of this thing that my doctor said is okay? Like, and the weirdest thing I think that's happened to me yet, a friend of mine who, you know, is a really good advocate for, you know, for body positivity, and she's a personal trainer. She ran a group that was called Eating the Food. And I didn't realize that it was eating disorder recovery group. I thought it was just, you know, being positive about, you know, eating food while still maintaining a healthy weight. Well, about a size up from my smallest. Instead of wanting to lose a little weight, I got jumped on because people were like, you know, what if you lose the weight and you find you're still okay, you know, 5 pounds up from there? I'm like, holy shit, whatever happened to respecting personal choices and the fact that I'm working on... You know, I talked to my doctor about this, and my doctor said it was fine. And my doctor even said to me, you know, you're okay at the weight you're at, but I understand why you want to lose the weight. You know, 15 pounds lighter would be fine for you. Like, people freaked out over me saying I wanted to lose just 15 pounds. And there was no respect for my autonomy at all. So I think when someone says, you know, I want to lose weight, talk to my doctor, I'm doing it in a healthful manner, there should be some respect for that and say, hey, good luck. If you need any help, let me know. That should be the end of the fucking conversation.
Yep.
Like, I'm there for you.
Yeah. Okay, we are coming up for the last 5 minutes, so I think it's time to do the wrap-up. And I keep forgetting what order. Do we do soapbox first or the final thoughts first? Which way shall we do it?
Do the soapbox first. I think we usually do.
All right. Well, as we say, Yvette, you've got your, we give our guest a soapbox moment to pump out their website and all that. So, yeah, you've got a few minutes to say what you want now.
First, thank you for having me on. If you want to go check out more from me, head over to scibabe.com or facebook.com/scibabe. Or to check out my brain droppings in 140 characters or less, I am at the SciBabe over on Twitter. And of course, I occasionally write for Cosmo, because why the fuck wouldn't we have a chemist writing for Cosmo? So thank you so much again.
All right, and we'll go for the final thoughts, Kitch.
Just what can I say? It's been brilliant to have you on, so thanks for coming on.
And Nathan?
Yeah, it's been great having you, and I think we need a lot more people like you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you now. I think you've got a lag, so just carry on.
Oh, okay. You said my name while I was talking, so.
All right.
I was just saying, it's been great having you, and we need a lot more people like you. Science communication and all that, and what you're doing is great. So, thanks.
All right, and Marty?
Yeah, I'll echo what the others have been saying, and I think it's really important with science communication and just reaching out to people, not just in the form of, you know, having academics sitting in their ivory towers coming up with all this new stuff, making science even more scary for people by making it more advanced without actually informing people about it. So I think science communication is something really important.
Okay, and Pumpkin, what do you have to say?
I'm going to have to disagree with everyone. It was terrible having you here. You swore too much.
I hate you too.
You hurt my delicate little feelings, and you
well,
destroyed
you're still
my
fucking
love
pumpkin, so.
No, genuinely good to have you on, and science communication is as much as science communication is good, knocking dumb motherfuckers down a peg that are trying to scam people, that's what we need more of.
The two often go hand in hand.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
It's good work if you can get it.
Yeah. Okay, everyone, and so that's coming up to the end of the show. So chat room, show your appreciation for Yvette. Again, Yvette, thanks for taking the time to come out, and sorry about the mix-up with the times, but it's been an absolute pleasure having you on, and as I say, the show will be uploaded next Saturday, the recording, I'll take it away, edit it, and make it sound really nice, and I think any other announcements, we're back in 2 weeks, and our guest is, it's Jamie Vernon, he is the editor-in-chief of American Scientist magazine. I keep getting it mixed up with the other magazine. Nathan, you know a tiny little bit about him, so please save me here.
Jamie Vernon?
Yeah, just give a tiny little bit of a preview to him.
Oh,
you know so far.
I know very little about him. I know about the magazine a little bit, and I've read a few articles here and there, but I don't know much about the man, Jamie Vernon. I'll have to do some digging myself.
Yeah, but from what you've seen, I think you've enjoyed what you've seen in the magazine.
Yes. It's a quality magazine.
So very sorry, Jamie. We don't know that much about you, but hopefully we'll find out a lot more about you.
Sure. We're professionals.
Yeah. And then 2 weeks after that, it's one that a lot of people have been waiting for, especially Zilla, who's not here today, and it's Seth Shostak is going to be on from SETI. I hope his name's a tongue twister to say. So yeah, Seth's going to be on. We've only got him for an hour, and Zilla's going to be handling all that, and Zilla's going to be having his man crush going severe for that one, I think. So yeah, everyone, if you've got
I really wish I could be there, but I'm going to be on vacation then, most likely.
I'll take a spot. I'll do it.
If you want, yeah, we'll be okay with that. So we're back. So everyone, you can see all the details below on the screen on how to get a hold of us if you have any further questions, and just enjoy the rest of the weekend wherever you are, and we'll see you all in 2 weeks. Good night, everyone.
Bye.
Good night.
Bye.